right. I think we should actually get started. People can walk in. I actually see quite a few people meandering about, but they'll come in. Thank you very much for coming. I'm going to be very brief. I've done enough talking. I've spammed all your inboxes over the last 3 days, so we're finally here. Very grateful to TM Krishna and Nityanand Jayaraman for agreeing to come here and speak about something that we usually do, but we actually should be speaking in our own classrooms. I'm really not going to stand between you and what is in store. Neither of them need any introduction, and in any case, you all know what the agenda is about and what we're going to be doing. So without further ado, Krishna and the floor is yours, so you can be your MC, you can be the director, actor.
Thank you, Deepak, and thank you all for coming. There was great debate on whether I should sing or not. I think that was resolved pretty easily with me not having much participation in the decision. So let's start with the song. This is a song probably some of you would have heard, some of you may have not. So let me just give you the context of the song. For those who heard it, it's called the Porumboku Padal. For those who have not heard it, I'll tell you what it is all about. And I think it's relevant to the conversations that we hope we can have today. Porumboku, for those who don't know, I mean, even if you know Tamil actually, there are many people who may not know that term. Porumboku basically is used in every Tamil cinema you will see. Somebody or the other is called a Porumboku. Poda Porumboku. And the understanding of the word is useless, good for nothing, incapable of anything. And it's definitely a derogatory term. And it is used very widely. The auto rickshaw person will tell you the same thing if you don't give the guy 10 rupees more. You know, so you hear it very often. And I'll be very honest, and that's the only way I also understood the term. The other way I knew Porumboku was one more way. For example, if there was some agricultural land, they'll say, your fence is here, that is Porumboku. And my understanding then was very simple, that is government land. Right? So this is my land, that is government land. But Porumboku actually is such a beautiful word, and I think it's important that we contemplate about it a little bit. The English equivalent sounds very fancy, the commons. I sound quasi-British when I say that. And it sounds so good to hear it when you say commons, but it doesn't sound as good when somebody says Porumboku. But Porumboku actually means commons. And what does the commons mean? It means places that are shared by communities without the idea of singular ownership. The idea that every one of us sitting in the room, and everybody not sitting in the room, everybody not in the campus, everybody far away from the campus, are all sharing in what is common. It could be water bodies, it could be marshlands, it could be grazing lands. And this is such a beautiful idea that we share something and we could all share in it. And at one level, it is also an idea of human beings, that there is some element, hopefully, of all of us, which is not just about what I am, what I own, where I belong, but the fact that as human beings too, there are elements of us that we would just share. And the most beautiful thing about sharing is that sharing is not about you. The moment you think sharing is about you, sharing is dead. And Porumboku pretty much epitomizes that idea. That's Porumboku for you. So in the north part of Chennai, in fact, if you say North Chennai, that itself is a signifier of what you're saying. North Chennai is almost a disaster zone today. There are 3 power plants. There are 2 ports, probably one more coming. There is a river called the Kosasthaliyar River, which is completely dead, polluted. The mangroves are taken over. There is fly ash fields all across the place. And nothing I'm saying is an exaggeration. I'm underplaying the reality of that space. This is a place where the fisher folk lived vibrantly in their occupation. And all this went there. And I can tell you, even traditionally, North Chennai is a place where we do make sure that all the very polluting things that we so essentially need is made. There's one other aspect to the word Porambok. The moment you say something is Porambok or good for nothing, you're also saying the people who live around that space are good for nothing and don't matter. Which is why everywhere across the world, the places where chemical factories are made, the places where thermal power plants are fixed, are not places where IIMs will be built. They are places where those living in those areas cannot even dream of the idea of an IIM. And this is a reality across the globe. This is not specific to Chennai or India. So North Chennai, Ennore, is a disaster zone. And the unfortunate fact is that the people of Chennai, we who live in southern part of Chennai, have very little connection with that part of the city. So when Nityanand, my dear friend here, came up with this idea that can we do something about this? Just raise awareness, you know, make it a point that we discuss. This Porambokku song, which is actually a Tamil rock song, I must say its original version is a Tamil rock song, was sent to me. It was also a fascinating question for me. I sing Carnatic music, in which the language used is the language of a certain cultural elite, even if it is the Tamil, for example. And the question that was in my head, can Carnatic music be sung in the franca lingua of the everyday person? And socially, politically, philosophically, it makes sense to me. It's a no-brainer, of course it can. But whether aesthetically it will work is something I never knew until we actually did it, because you can hold a position, but aesthetically, will it be cohesive? Does it work as a song? Does local words come and match with some raga? These are all important things. And this is how Porambokku song came into being. It's a question that challenged the idea of ownership, challenged marginalization, the fact that we are blind to communities, we are blind to people, not necessarily because we are purposely blind to them. That's very important. It's not like we have an agenda to be blind to people, I think. Just that we're just blind, just don't see it. That's all. And I think Porambokku was a way of asking those questions and asking very specific questions to the city of Chennai, to the people of larger Chennai, highlighting the issue of Ennore. So it's a political song, it's an aesthetic song. It is also, for me, a reflective philosophical song. So I will sing Porambokku Padal, and then I'll let Nityanand do all the talking. Porambokku, how many of you understand Tamil? Quick question. Okay, good. For those who don't, you can go to YouTube, there's subtitles. Porambokku unakku illa, porambokku enakku illa, porambokku oorukku, porambokku bhoomikku, porambokku unakku illa, porambokku enakku illa, porambokku oorukku, porambokku bhoomikku, porambokku un porupu, porambokku en porupu, porambokku un porupu, porambokku en porupu, porambokku oor porupu, iyarkaikku bhoomikku, samagarigamapa, sani samagari samagari gamapa sani samagari sapadani dabadamagari saga vellam vandu pona pinne kattutadu enna vellam vandu pona pinne கத்துட்டது என்ன ஏரிக்குள்ள கட்டடத்தை கட்டுறது என்ன வெள்ளம் வந்து போன பின்னே கத்துட்டது என்ன ஏரிக்குள்ள கட்டடத்தை கட்டுறது என்ன மழை தண்ணி கடலுக்கு வழிகிற இடத்துல கான்கிரீட் கட்டடம் தேவயாக்கண் சாமி பதவசாசகாரி மாதபாமதாபசாமதாபமாபகாமரீச பாமத முன்னே நகரத்து குள்ள நதிகள் ஓடல முன்னே நகரத்து குள்ள நதிகள் ஓடல நதிகள் சுத்திதான் நகரம் வழங்குச்சு மழை தண்ணிய காத்திருந்த ஏரிக்கு மழை தண்ணிய காத்திருந்த ஏரிக்கு புறம்போக்குன்னு பேரு இருந்துச்சு மாகபமதாபசனிசமரிசாதபமபதபமாரி எண்ணூறுல மின்னிலயம் கட்டினது பின்னே எண்ணூறுல மின்னிலயம் கட்டினது பின்னே ஆத்துல ஆயிரம் ஏக்கர் சாம்பலாம் கண்ண கடலையும் நதியையும் பிரிச்சு வச்சான் கடலையும் நதியையும் பிரிச்சு வச்சான் வெள்ளவானத்த கருப்படிச்சான் நிதபா மகரீரி சரிமாரி நிதபா மகரீரி சரிமாரி எண்ணூறுல செஞ்சு முடிச்சா உன்னூறுல செய்ய வருவான் எண்ணூறுல செஞ்சு முடிச்சா உன்னூறுல செய்ய வருவான் கேள்வி கேட்டமே கிணிண்டியான் வட சுடுவான் கேள்வி கேட்டமே கிணியடியான் வட சுடுவான் கேள்வி கேட்ட மேகினியான் வட சுடுவான் சானித சரி மாகரிச நிரபமபதாபமபகாரிச நிரிச மாதக மதபகாரிச நிரிச வளர்ச்சி வேலை வாய்ப்பு எல்லாம் வெட்டிசாக்கு வளர்ச்சி வேலை வாய்ப்பு எல்லாம் வெட்டி சாக்கு ஏறி வித்தவனுக்கு ஏறி வெறும் புறம் போக்கு வளர்ச்சி வேலை வாய்ப்பு எல்லாம் வெட்டி சாறும் போறம் போக்கு அப்போ நீயும் நானும் என்ன கணக்கு அப்போ நீயும் நானும் என்ன கணக்கு அடனியும் நானும் போரம்போக்கு அடனியும் நானும் போரம்போக்கு நானான் போரம்போக்கு நானான் போரம்போக்கு போக்கு எனக்கு இல்ல புறம்போக்கு ஊருக்கு புறம்போக்கு பூமிக்கு புறம்போக்கு உனக்கு இல்ல புறம்போக்கு எனக்கு இல்ல புறம்போக்கு ஊருக்கு புறம்போக்கு பூமிக்கு புறம்போக்கு ஊருக்கு புறம்போக்கு பூமிக்கு புறம்போக்கு ஊருக்கு புறம்போக்கு Thank you very much. I guess one way to begin the conversation today is to maybe temporarily for the next 1 hour think of all ourselves as Porambokku. I think that'll be a wonderful way to have today's conversation. Thank you.
My song's not going to be as good as this one. I actually have a story to tell. But before I start the story, I would like you to be listeners of the story to forget that the main character in the story is a company called Hindustan Unilever or Unilever. The reason why I think that is important to at least be conscious of the fact that we're talking about Unilever is because Unilever is Unilever. They are big, they smell good, they dress well, they're cute, they're cuddly, they give us all the nice things that we want. We brush our teeth with Unilever, we drink our morning coffee or morning tea or whatever with Unilever, we wash ourselves with Unilever. We're doing everything with Unilever. That includes you, the person who's against Unilever, the person who thinks about Unilever. All of us are part of the same family. So let's forget Unilever for the time being. Let's also forget all the wonderful things that they've done for us for the time being and focus on the story. And the story, which I will begin now, like all good stories, this story also begins in the United States of America. So, I bring this up because this was a very important person in the global environmental movement, a woman called Rachel Carson, who was a wildlife biologist and wrote a book called Silent Spring, for which she was slammed. And whenever women speak sense, they're usually called shrill, weird, witches, and this woman was no exception. She was targeted by the industry and her life was made miserable for saying pesticides cause harm. The book was called Silent Spring, and despite the powerful global chemical industry, which was essentially born out of the Second World War, out of chemicals that were used for killing people. And the companies that were manufacturing these chemicals now had no people to kill, so they targeted, they changed this. This is companies like Bayer and Syngenta. All those companies have come in from the wartime large companies called IG Farben. It was one large multinational that was based in Germany that then split up into several smaller companies that manufactures everything from dyes, dye stuffs, petroleum products, and pesticides. This kind of launched the global environmental movement, but particularly in North America, where people started possible time when, because of the chemicals, all the bird life is wiped out and the spring is silent without bird call. Around the same time, there was also a growing realization of a class of chemicals called persistent bioaccumulative toxins. And they are persistent because they don't disappear once they're put out in the environment. And because they are toxins, they are available to do damage over a very long time because they are persistent. And they are bioaccumulative, which means once they go into your body, they keep increasing in your body and also along the food chain. I'll come to that in a bit. And one of those chemicals, there are many of these things, DDT was one of them, polychlorinated biphenyls was another, mercury was another such persistent bioaccumulated toxin. Another thing about mercury and these toxins is that these are chemicals that might be released over here, but this chemical will travel very far without a passport, like a terrorist, and move to different places and cause harm in very distant lands. This is the Great Lakes area in North America. And the Great Lakes was particularly affected because around Lake Erie, Lake Ontario, there was a very intense industrialization with heavy industries. And in this place, in, is there a pointer that I can use? In Lake Ontario, in upstate New York, there was a town called Watertown. And this story kind of begins in Watertown, where in the 50s, a company called Chesbrough Ponds set up a thermometer manufacturing facility, a clinical thermometer manufacturing facility, it's a mercury thermometer manufacturing factory, on the banks of a river called the Black River, which drained into the Lake Ontario. This chemical, this company operated for a number of years, was the mainstay of the town's economy, and was very important for the town, because the town was a glass manufacturing town, that's how it began. The point, this is point, is it? Okay. So we have the Black River is over here, and the town is right over here, and the company was doing what it was doing. It was manufacturing thermometers, making money out of it, helping people surely, but helping people was not the key intention. The key intention was to make a product to make money for the company. I'm not saying it with any value-loaded stuff. Corporations, when you talk about corporations, when you say a good corporation, bad corporation, there are no good corporations and bad corporations. There are successful corporations and there are failures. And a successful corporation, ideally, makes a lot of money for its shareholders by lawful means. A successful corporation can also be a company that makes a lot of money for its shareholders by unlawful means and does not get caught. That's a very successful company. There are lots of companies like that around. You have unsuccessful companies that basically either following the law or violating the law, do not make money, or even worse, get caught. Because you have to be really stupid to get caught in a situation where corporations rule the world. So you have this company sitting over here, generating a lot of jobs, a very important mainstay, and all of a sudden, in the Great Lakes area, they find a buildup of a number of toxins, including mercury. And so the United States government and the Canadian government, because this is a shared Porombok, the Great Lakes area, and so they get together, they set up something called the International Joint Commission on these kind of persistent toxins and decide to start eliminating, reducing and eliminating these toxins. So the reduction and elimination involved primarily tightening the screws. And so the screws were tightened on a number of companies, including Chesbrough Pond's factory in Watertown, upstate New York. And they decided to do a quick Swatch America over there. And they swatched that company all the way to India. The company shut down over there and it was moved to Kodaikanal. A second-hand factory from Watertown, New York was moved to Kodaikanal where there was no industry. It was welcomed. I mean, people thought that the best thing to happen to Kodaikanal was the arrival of this industry. Also because it is the only industry in Kodaikanal. The company came there. They set up in a place called St. Mary's Road, which is primarily a residential and a forest area. They, in their declaration to the government of India, it was a 100% export-oriented unit. The government of India felt that dollars were very important. At that time, dollars were very, very important foreign exchange. And so the 100% export-oriented unit was given the status of the holy cow. Nobody could mess with it. And no matter what happens, that 100% export-oriented unit gets what it wants. These are the kinds of conditions that are normally given. Because they're told that this is very important for India's development, so shut up. The company came there calling themselves a glass manufacturing facility and set up, converted that area from a residential use to industrial use, saying it's a non-polluting industry. Either people were stupid, we did not know what is happening in New York, in America, in other places where mercury was already an extremely identified as an extremely toxic chemical. There was something called the Minamata disaster which had already happened in Japan at least 3 decades prior to this, which was still unfolding as the factory was being set up over here. Or there may have been a large number of regulators who knew which side of the bread was buttered, which is, do we actually exercise the law, exercise due caution and due diligence and prevent this company from setting in? Or do we just say it's okay because somebody else is being hurt and the greater common good cannot be achieved without this sacrifice? One doesn't know. The factory came to Tamil Nadu, to Kodaikanal, a beautiful hill station. This is a little bit about mercury. So as I said, there are two things that happens with elements or heavy metals and toxins like mercury. One is called bioaccumulation and the other is called biomagnification. Bioaccumulation happens inside your body. You take in something, you don't excrete it. It's like a recurring deposit. So as time goes, you have higher and higher plus interest levels growing up in your body. And that becomes lethal. So within the same species, the levels of the contaminant or the pollutant grows. Then you have biomagnification, where there's a magnification. So one small fish accumulates over its lifetime a good amount of mercury. And about 10 small fishes are eaten by a larger fish. And that gets 10 times the accumulated dose of mercury in its body. And so on up to the highest predators, which are human beings, in addition to other cute animals like the polar bear. This is from the Minamata disaster. Mercury is an extremely potent neurotoxin. The science was established. There was no doubt about it. The industry fought it like they fought tobacco, like they fought lead. They fought the evidence that mercury was toxic. And it is known that it's not just toxic to the central nervous system of adults, but also of developing fetuses. So children born to exposed mothers were born like this. This child had been deformed from her birth. It is also a very potent kidney toxin. So it goes into your body and deposits and starts hurting your kidney. And a lot of people who are exposed to mercury often die of kidney failure. So where was the factory situated? Knowing what it did in 1983, when it relocated from Watertown to Kodaikanal, they located the factory on top of a very important part of the Palni Hills. This is called the Pambar Shola. Shola is a very exquisite, temperate, kind of a sub-montane tropical evergreen forest, which means it's a very, very nice place to be. But it's also very important hydrologically because sholas are found as a complex with grasslands on either side. And the grasslands harvest the water, send it to the shola. The shola does not have much soil. It has a lot of humus. So when the water falls, because of the numerous tiers of leaves and foliage, the water doesn't come down hard on the ground. And so it drips there. All sholas give birth to rivers. Every single shola will be squeezing out some stream or the other. This shola is no exception. There's a stream called the Pambar stream, which drains this factory site. So if you look at this factory site, it is located on top of the ridge. It's like spitting poison into your overhead tank. This is the overhead tanks for the Periculum Plains and the Madurai area. This river goes from down the slope, comes down to Varaha Nadi and enters the Vaigai river, which is a very important river for South Tamil Nadu. Mercury is particularly badly behaved when it comes in contact with water, because in water it converts from its elemental form into another very deadly form called methyl mercury, which is what caused the Minamata disaster. Mercury itself is toxic, but that toxin is primarily through inhalation. When it gets in the air, it's a semi-volatile. It's a liquid, but at room temperature it starts volatilizing, and as it volatilizes it moves. Because it's heavy, it comes down, and from there again it volatilizes, moves. It's called a grasshopper effect, and it moves long distances. And where it comes in contact with water, the microorganisms convert into methyl mercury, and that starts building up and causing harm both to wildlife and to fish consumers. On the other side, you have, this is not the watershed that is drained from here. From here the water drains south, but on the northern side you have another shola called the Bombay Shola. And the Bombay Shola eventually drains into the Kodaikanal Lake. So all the air emissions from the factory, when it blows towards the north, gets deposited in the Bombay Shola, gets washed off with rainwater and goes into the Kodaikanal Lake, contaminating the fish over there. Between 1983 and 2001, the factory operated with absolutely no controls. Why are there no controls? There are no controls because Unilever is Unilever, Vedanta is Vedanta, Tata is Tata. These are big bosses in the places where they operate. They are bigger than the local government. They are bigger than the state government. They are bigger than the national government. They actually are bigger than the United Nations. They call the shots. They make the policy. They tell you what is acceptable limits, what is not acceptable limit, what is poisonous, what is not poisonous, what levels are safe for your food, what levels of sugar in your blood are considered to be acceptable, not acceptable. Everything is influenced extremely strongly by them. It doesn't mean that people don't have a voice. People have a voice, but that voice is extremely feeble when compared to the very powerful voice that is ringing from every corridor inside the parliament, outside the parliament. So between 1983 and 2001, the factory operated with very little controls in terms of occupational safety, very little controls in terms of environmental quality and protection. In December, I was called by a friend of mine who lived across the street from the Unilever factory in Kodaikanal, and he said, "Nithi, I went to the scrapyard to purchase a wooden window frame. And when I went to the scrapyard, I found a large, about 7 tons, but at the time we couldn't quantify it. It's a very large heap of broken thermometers. And it can't be from any hospital because Kodaikanal does not have any sizable hospital. The only thing it could be from is from the company." So very quietly documented, so I went there to document it. Not only did we go to the scrapyard, but we also went behind the factory. Usually, when you go to a factory, the most interesting place in the factory is the backside. Because the front side says nice things. It says, be good to the environment. Don't slap your neighbor. Behind is where the action happens. Because behind is off bounds. You don't want to take people to the backside. And when you go to the backside, you have to creep and crawl and get there. And there, lo and behold, we again found drums of empty drums of mercury containers out there, tarry heaps that where something had been burned, and mercury waste that had been spread around in the shola behind the factory site. We documented this in March 2001. We organized this march. We told the town people, the workers. Many of the workers were very upset also because they felt that their jobs would go, which I think that it would. There were 121 workers employed at the time, but a lot of the ex-workers also came because they understood the threat that the factory had posed. And there was a march from the factory to from the scrapyard to the factory gate, demanding action against the company. And the company manager denied on camera that anything had left the factory. And then the news presser said, if anything has left the factory, it is not hazardous. And if it is hazardous, it went beyond, it went there in violation of our control system, which means that they said a breach in procedure is what they call this extremely heinous event. 7 tons of mercury dumped inside the scrapyard. We later found out that close to 400 tons of mercury containing waste had actually been sold to different places, including to marble manufacturers who convert those thermometer containing mercury into marbles that children play, put in their mouth, and God knows what else. In breach of established procedure. This resulted in the closure of the factory because it was a very, very grave violation of the environmental norms. And the reason why the factory was closed down was because there was one straightforward, upright woman in the pollution control board. If that woman had not been there, we could have shouted ourselves hoarse and nothing would have happened. But that woman took immediate action, shut the factory down. Her name is Sheila Rani Chokat, and she immediately also asked for the cleanup of the factory, of the scrapyard. So the cleanup of the factory was done, the scrapyard was done. She also invited all the community people, asked for their advice. We presented them with protocol as to how cleanups are done in other countries. And men in suits came in with full body suits, with masks, came in to handle the mercury thermometers. That freaked the living daylights out of the workers who were watching this, because they had been handling this very casually, and when they saw the way it had to be handled, they were like, what the hell is happening, when we were not ever told this. The company in 2001, the minute it was shut down, it commissioned a report by a very reputed consultant called URS Dames and Moore. The interesting thing about consultants is, even though they are very good scientifically and have all the expertise, they usually sing the tune that you want them to sing, because you need to get a consultancy again. So if it's an internal report where the company says only for my internal consumption, so tell me the truth, then you get a true diagnosis. But if it's a report for external consumption, the company will tell you this is what you can say, this is what you can't say. And so the company came, URS Dames and Moore came and did a analysis. They took soil samples, water samples, etc. And they did something called a mercury balance. A mercury balance is how much mercury came into the factory as mercury, as raw material, how much mercury went out with your thermometers as finished product, how much mercury is contained in the broken thermometers that we have stored, how much mercury has escaped the factory in breach of established procedures and been dumped in various places, again a quantification, how much mercury is inside the effluent treatment plant sludge, and then you have a figure that is unaccounted for. And this unaccounted for is likely to be what has been discharged into the environment and has probably entered people's bodies, etc. They came up with a figure of 559 kilograms in 2001. Then the workers said, you've done the mass balance wrong, because you forgot to factor in an import of 10 tons of mercury from Bombay in such and such a year. The company had already done the mass balance and had balanced the left-hand side with the right-hand side beautifully and said 559 kilograms has been discharged, and the workers come in with an additional 10 tons to the left-hand side, which means now it's 10.5 tons is unaccounted for. But that's not the way consultants work. They're like accountants. You give them 10 tons, no problem. Give me a few days. They came back. They increased the amount of mercury in each thermometer by a few milligrams. Nicely balanced. And they had to, of course, make it credible. So they came up with a figure of 1,300 kilograms, 1.3 tons of mercury discharged into the Pamba Shola. Mercury is so potent that if you have 1 gram of mercury deposited in a year, aerially, over a 25-acre lake, it can poison all the fish in the lake. It can make the fish so contaminated that it is poisonous for consumption. They've dumped 1.3 tons into the watershed forest of the Vaigai River. Inside the factory, the levels of mercury were up to 50,000, not were, they still are, up to 50,000 times. These are the company's own figures. There's been zero verification done by Tamil Nadu Pollution Control Board. They probably have taken three samples of soil in their entire 18 years. So the only data we have is the company's data. We will go with it, no problem. 1.3 tons is what they're talking about. Fish samples in Kodai Lake, fish samples in the Periculum Plains were also found to contain very high levels of mercury. The factory had about 1,100 workers who had gone through the factory gates. It's a factory that requires not more than 200 people at any point, which means they have a very high worker turnover rate. In a place like Kodaikanal, where jobs are very hard to come by, why are people quitting their jobs? So out of the 1,100 workers, most of them said they had absolutely no idea that mercury was toxic. We used to play with mercury. There's a guy called Kaviraj who was working in the oven room. So there's a place where the mercury waste is put in and it is recovered. So it's a very hot place. There's a lot of mercury fumes over there. We used to play with mercury. There would be puddles of mercury on the floor. We would kick that and watch it scatter into tiny beads. Because it was noisy in the distillation room, whenever I wanted to call my colleague, I'd scoop up some mercury and fling it on him. So when that happened, mercury got into the hair, it got into the mustaches. They go home, they give a hug to their baby, and the baby also gets a nice dose of mercury at a very vulnerable age. Lots of children were hurt. Mercury is also a very potent poison that affects the teeth. And this is a guy called Jiaz Mohammed, who's a very strong man, completely weak and debilitated by the time when we saw him. This is about 4 years ago, and he had lost all his teeth. We did a survey of about 160 people, out of which 102 people had serious dental caries and problems that could be attributable to mercury. Mercury affects the brain of a developing fetus. This is Nitish. This young boy was born. His mother, Margaret, was working for a very short while in the company. And she recalls, she was working in the packing section where mercury, the thermometer would sometimes fall down and break. And she was exposed to mercury. She got pregnant when she was there. She decided to leave at that time, just to kind of, go and spend the pregnancy with her mother. And she gave birth to a son who has a very serious brain disorder. He can now kind of take care of himself, but needs help. This is Esther and David. Esther Amma's son quit school, did not want to go work. He just wanted to waste his time. Then his mother and father kind of scolded him and said, go get yourself a life, get a job. So he and his friend, Brito and his friend, got a job in the factory. And they were very elated because the factory supervisor would give him all kinds of jobs, not just in one place. Someday he would be gardening, another day he would be fixing pipes. So he says, I'm learning everything. It's going really good. And then one evening, which was a very, very rainy day, he comes home. There's no electricity. And he felt very tired. He said, I'm going to lie down. He lay down and he called his mother and said, I feel nauseous. He went to the toilet. And on the way to the toilet, he threw up and went back to bed. His mother said, okay, you go back to bed. I'll clean up. And when she went there and she put the lantern over there, it was a pool of blood. He had lost his kidneys. The Esther and David sold their cows, they sold their house, they sold everything, all the jewelry. They lost all their savings, they went into debt and could not save Brito because it cost about 1,200 rupees at the time for dialysis. It had to be done every week. And they lost all their money, they lost their son. And even to bury him, they had to borrow money. And this woman said, my son would not have died if I had not asked him to go and work in Unilever. These are just a sample of food. This is the other one. This is Brito. That's Brito. He died at a very young age. He died at about 21. These are all people, most of whom have died because of kidney failure. There were 11 people. Out of 11 people, several had died of kidney failure. And kidney failure is very, very rapid. It's the onset. Between the onset and the death, you have about 6 to 8 months. So when all this happened and the factory was shut down, we actually thought that, Unilever being Unilever because it's cute, cuddly and smells good would really be responsive to the difficulties over here. And Unilever is also a member of the UN's Global Compact. And its CEO, Mr. Paul Polman, of course, he took over much later. Before that, there were other people, but the current CEO is also the UN Champion of the Earth awardee. I mean, he actually champions the Earth. So we thought that besides the corporate profits would also be a very important place in his scheme of things for the earth and for people. The Global Compact Charter says, The right to collective bargaining of workers and the right to associate for workers is something that anybody who signs on to the compact is required to recognize. It also requires companies to apply the precautionary principle to environmental challenges. The demands from 2001 till date have been pretty much constant. Now, of course, we have one set of demands that have been removed. I will tell you about that in a bit. But it is an international standard cleanup because India, Indians, Tamilians, Karnataka people are no less than anybody else, anywhere else in the world. It needs to be treated at par with the best international practice. Best international practice left to a bunch of experts will become anything, because experts without any kind of oversight tend to get corrupted. So we need to have expertise very strongly on a leash, and that leash is transparency, that leash is public oversight. So we wanted a cleanup, and the levels of cleanup to be determined scientifically, but scientifically does not mean by PhDs, it means by people who are being overseen, because PhDs often, for in order to be scientific, you not only have to have the knowledge, but you also have to have the spine to speak up, to tell the truth. And that often is missing in a lot of scientific institutions. And so having a spine, and sometimes what happens when there are people watching, the spine automatically comes. So we wanted the public oversight to be a very important part. The second, of course, is worker compensation and the rehabilitation, medical rehabilitation of the worker. And this must not be done through CSR. This must be done as the duty of a polluter. Now, what does this all mean? For a company like, I mean, you guys definitely have, Unilever as a case study. Union Carbide for the bad guy and Unilever for the good guy. Actually, Mr. Paul Polman sits on the board of both companies, Dow Chemical and Unilever. But Unilever, if you look at it, they have promised $110,000, $110 million for Swachh Bharat. None of it is going to Kodaikanal. No swatching happening over there. Well, this money is all about sale of domix. More toilets you build, there'll be a need to clean up the toilets, and hopefully we'll have domix coming out in small sachets, so bottom pyramid can be nicely addressed. You have a revenue of about $62 billion, out of which about $8.9 billion is spent on the brand, on saying that you're a good guy, on selling the good guy image. A lot of this money also gets spent in different places in terms of buying legitimacy, by doing things as CSR, by investing in universities. You also have the cost of, so here we have estimated the cost of rehabilitation. In fact, it came to exactly that. $10 million is what the secret settlement was. Nobody knows about it, and I didn't tell you this. But everybody in Kodaikanal talks about it. It's a $10 million, roughly, secret settlement that was signed between the workers and the company. If the word around town is something to be believed. The estimated cost of mercury spill cleanup, we don't know. We're just putting a float there, $5 million. We have Mr. Polman's remuneration for 2018 is $15 million. $15 million spent, I will shut up. And there would not be a case study presentation over here. It's been 18 years, and that money has not been spent on the cleanup. The 18 years of, when 15 years of unsuccessful campaigning, 2001 to 2016, 2015, we didn't really achieve much beyond, besides scratching the surface. Why? Because $8 billion was playing. That's a media spend. So when you go to, we organize a press conference, lots of media come, but nobody carries it. Because one of the biggest advertisers in the media is Unilever. So you have to do really very strong circus tactics in order to attract the attention of the media. We decided to give up on the media and decided to go to the social media. Also, we decided to give up on the government, because I need to speak to the Malik of the government. I need to speak to the master of the government. Who is pulling the strings of the government? My government is not mine. It belongs to somebody else. Somebody is calling the shots. So I have to bypass the government because they are irrelevant. And I also have to be speaking to people who matter as far as Unilever is concerned, which means not these brown people who are still not used enough fair and lovely to become fair, but we need to talk to the people who are already white. So our audience was North America, Europe, which is where Unilever is headquartered, and our target was Mr. Paul Polman. The reason why we targeted Paul Polman also is because Mr. Polman is the only one, I think, ideologically, if he's really sincere, and I think he is thinking about business as a way of social good, big business as a way of doing, as a force of good. I don't believe in that bunkum, but then If there is somebody who believes in it and who's sincerely working in it towards it, I would respect that. And so that's the reason why we approached Mr. Paul Polman and asked him if he could walk his talk. And we decided to do it through a song that some of you may have seen. It is sung by a Chennai-based artist called Sophia Ashraf. And it's in rap style, and I'll let the song do the talking. So fortunately for us, the video had some magic. The magic was a woman named Nicki Minaj who tweeted, "Wow." So the video kind of went viral. Often it's thought that, you know, videos go viral because the video is good. No, we made several videos that have not gone viral, not because they are bad, but because there's no magic. So most of our campaigning is actually about 20% magic, I mean 20% hard work, and about 80% magic. And most of the time the magic does not happen. In this instance, it did, and Mr. Polman was, it was also connected to a signature campaign through an online portal called Jatka, and so Mr. Polman was being sent emails for every click, and this resulted in Mr. Polman returning from his vacation in Greece to a big controversy. Something that had been tightly contained to the town of Kodaikanal. Nobody outside Kodaikanal knew all of a sudden. He tweeted that this matter has been going on for too long. It needed to be resolved quickly. And we agreed that it did need to be resolved quickly. And then we also talked about the double standards in the cleanup and highlighted that the standard that they had set for India, for Kodaikanal, was 20 times weaker than what is considered to be safe in residential soils in the UK and 66 times weaker than what is considered to be safe for plant and animal life and soil quality in the Netherlands. These are the two countries where Unilever had its headquarters. So we thought that, you know, highlighting the fact that there is a double standard would make people quickly jump up and say, okay, no double standards. In fact, it did. Mr. Polman immediately sent back a note saying, no double standards acceptable. And again, we agreed. But since then, nothing has really happened. What did happen was, when the thing went viral, and all the photographs of people with disabilities and people being hurt happened, within 6 months, that's in August 2015, the video was, became very popular. In March 2016, the company settled with the workers. So essentially what had happened is, 15 years of negotiation, no movement. And negotiation is a very misleading word, because negotiation assumes discussions between two equals. Workers are not equal with Unilever. Workers are here, and Unilever is over there. And all the people who speak English, look good, smell good, look cute, all those people are with Unilever. So you have to fight not just against Unilever, you have to fight against government of Tamil Nadu, you have to fight against Tamil Nadu Pollution Control Board, you have to fight against Ministry of Environment, and you will not get any scientists or doctors coming out to speak for you or to tell you whether your ailment is actually because of this, because all of them are scared. They're scared for one reason or the other. The more privileged you are, the more scared you are. So nobody spoke up for them. So we had 16, 15 years of silence, and the 15 years of silence was broken by this young woman who rapped out Kodaikanal Wont. It got the eyeballs, and all of a sudden, the corporate responsibility of a multinational corporation was executed thanks to a rap song. So this is responsibility by rap. So now we have to make a rap song for Vedanta, one for Tata, one for Ambani, one for Adani. We have to make many rap songs and hope that they go viral, because that seems to be the only way to get any kind of recognition. So people usually ask, why are you not talking to the government of India? Why are you not talking to the government of Tamil Nadu? Government of Tamil Nadu and government of India do not matter. We have to go to their bosses, the ones who are telling them, telling us what we should do, what we can speak on, what we cannot speak on, what we stand to lose if we speak the truth. These are the people that need to be bypassed, and we have to go straight to the master. Right now, the only masters I know are the corporations, and that is why we're targeting the corporation, not just with the hope of getting concessions, but to highlight the fact that corporations are an inherently unsustainable entity, the existence of which is contrary to democracy. Both cannot coexist in the form that corporations currently are. The half-resolved thing was, of course, the worker settlement. But in the settlement, interestingly, the workers are now no longer part of the environmental fight, because that they should not associate with the environmental campaign. So global compact be damned, where we talk about recognizing the right to associate, that is for the United Nations. In Kodaikanal, the right to associate does not exist. In fact, they cannot even speak about things. They cannot speak about their past ailments. There's a virtual gag order. The gag order is unconstitutional, cannot be maintained in a court of law, but people are usually more loyal than corporations are, and so when they sign something, they stick to it and they keep quiet. We also think that it's a good thing for workers to take it easy, because they've had a very long fight, and I think there are people with privilege who need to step in and fight for them. What is very interesting about this thing on the left-hand side is this whole thing about stakeholders. Stakeholder is a very dirty word. Stakeholders are the people who coined the word stakeholders are people from extremely privileged sections of society. And these people define who the stakeholders will be. So if you look at this, in the stakeholder matrix, which Unilever's consultant has given, to oversee the cleanup, you have Tamil Nadu Pollution Control Board, which is Unilever. You have the Scientific Experts Committee, Unilever. Hindustan Unilever is Unilever. NIDI, which is a consultant paid by Unilever, so that's Unilever. And you have Environmental Resources Management, another consultant that's paid by Unilever, which is Unilever. This is the stakeholder matrix. There is no people in this. People are missing in the stakeholder. So this talks about the amount of importance that these large corporations and also people generally in the business, when you talk about fairness, it is only when I attack Vedanta, we'll say, oh, but we have to ask Vedanta's point of view. When you're reproducing their press releases, when you're having them come and speak in the parliament, in college campuses, there's no emphasis on saying that, why don't we bring in the people who are affected by Tata in Orissa and have them speak in the campus, just to give balance. There has to be fair stakeholder representation. That is not done. Stakeholder representation comes in when the elites are targeted. The refusal to clean up to global standards, in this also they kept the people away, said that from 2005 to 2015, there was a committee called the Local Area Environment Committee that was formed by the Supreme Court Monitoring Committee. And this committee was supposed to oversee the determination of the cleanup target levels. In 2005, because the committee raised issues, they were silenced. There was no meeting of the committee convened between 2005 and 2015, and then a committee meeting by rap song. We had a rap song, and all of a sudden, democracy blossomed in Tamil Nadu, and the local area environment committee was called in for a consultation, and again we said what we said, which is the standards are very weak, and nothing has happened since. These are some of the images that are olden day Unilever wanting to make people white. I mean, they have a, you know, when they say fair play, this is what they mean. Everybody becomes fair, and then we play, and then we have fair play. So these are all images of Lux, Pierce, Sunlight from those days. Things have not really changed. Now they don't show African people with woolly hair. They show other people getting confident as they grow fairer. And this is considered to be a great thing. And for a country like India, where, I mean, honestly, I come from a state of darkies, and we feel perfectly fine when they come out and we're born. You don't have the sense that dark is not nice. That is a created thing. Who creates it? You have $8 billion in advertising expenditure. You create a need, you supply that need, and you call it deadly marketing. So I think that these are things that need to be really looked at, because this racism, this kind of a double standard that anything goes in order to sell a product is not a nice way to do business. So all I'm saying over here, just in conclusion, is if we were to say that this is a company that's called, let's say, Narasimha Reddy Mercury Dirty Company, instead of calling it Hindustan Unilever, just give it a different name and look at whether you would treat this pollution incident differently. In every instance, like with Vedanta, they said, how can you shut down such a big company? Which means it is okay to shut down small companies. Small offenders, okay. Elite offenders, do not touch. Because elite offenders will, that is not right. If the law applies equally. Over here, what are we asking for? We are asking for a fraction of expenditure. Forget the corporate social responsibility. If you are a corporation, and if you had any damn sense, you would have cleaned up and claimed a coup, saying that we are responsible. Then you don't have to spend money painting yourself as responsible. You've actually done something that's responsible. But I think there is something in the corporation's genes that prevents corporations from admitting guilt, because admission of guilt is something that is human. A corporation is a non-human. It's not a living entity. It is an artificial construct. And this artificial construct has been able to gain so much loyalty amongst us. We say it's a good corporation, it's a nice corporation, a bad corporation, this, that, and the other. But corporations, like Milton Friedman has said, the corporation is like a wall. Does a wall have corporate responsibility, or does a wall have responsibility? It does not. The same way a corporation also does not have responsibility. It is meant to do something. It is meant to improve shareholder returns. And it's supposed to do it lawfully. But most of the time it does it by externalizing cost to the porombooks, to the commons, to the people who live in the commons. And here all we are asking for, and here I think I'd just like to end with an invitation to you guys to participate in the conversation. I'm not going to rob away your campus job. You want to take a job in Unilever, please go ahead and take it. That is your call. But just because you take it, Unilever doesn't become a saint in Kodaikanal. What they did in Kodaikanal remains. About 70% of Indonesia and Malaysia's rainforests have disappeared because of palm oil. Palm oil is a key ingredient in virtually every single product that Unilever makes. If you're talking about the sachets as a revolution, you have to look at what is happening in terms of the new Swachh Bharat, clean up the plastic. Unilever is 70 billion sachets just in India for shampoos. Where do you think this goes? You think Mr. Polman is collecting into the Swachh Bharat money? This goes into your commons, it goes into your beaches, it goes into the sea, it goes into the bodies of the fish and comes back to you. Plastic does not degrade. When it becomes smaller and smaller, it goes and lodges, because fish tend to eat it thinking it's food, and it comes back. All of us are part plastic because we've already ingested it. So this is a very serious issue. So we can't be looking at these issues from a point of view of whether Unilever is doing good to us, or this company is doing good to us, or that company is doing good to us. If it is doing good to you, take it. But do they have to do it lawfully? Shall we have some minimum basic agreements? Do they have to be accountable? If they have to be accountable, then they have to be broken down to a size that they are accountable. We cannot hold them accountable now. You cannot hold them accountable now. In fact, in your institute, I challenge you that it will be very, very difficult to even think critically about Unilever, because Unilever may have a very strong hold in large institutions, in IITs, IIMs, other universities. They have a very strong presence. And people feel threatened when we go and talk. And that's why I'm saying that I'm not here to ask you to do anything. You don't have to give up your job. You don't have to boycott Pepsodent. You can eat two tubes of it. I don't really have a problem. What is your take on this issue of Kodaikanal cleanup? And then if you want to have further discussions on whether corporations are sustainable, this is my point of view. You might have a completely different point of view, but it is possible to discuss it. But if you discuss it with some amount of openness, without feeling vulnerable about whether our lifestyle will be compromised by admitting the truth, I think we can get somewhere. Thank you.
So why am I here? I mean, that's the question I'll begin with. I'm no expert. I'm not a long-time campaigner for social injustice or environmental injustice like Niti is. And neither do I have the expertise of the technicalities of what has happened in Kodaikanal. I think I'm here because I'm very much like all of you. I think that's my only proper reason to be in your presence. The fact is, I'm here because I'm privileged, like every one of us sitting in this room. And which is exactly why I think we should ask these questions. Because there is this belief that because we associate with everything that comes around the privileged world, which is Unilever too. Unilever is part of all of our lives every day. Therefore, there is a gratitude that we hold towards these things. That after all, we've used these products. After all, so much is provided. And after all, we have benefited. It's interesting, it's we the privileged who have everything who think more like this. Isn't that something very peculiar about it? That we feel somehow that therefore the idea of questioning or challenging and asking very legitimate questions, by the way, is somehow destroying the very environment that we have built. In a way, actually, we are part of Unilever. Actually, Unilever is not an external entity. Unilever is part of who you and I are. The way we are, the way we dress, the way we speak, the way what we consume is why Unilever exists, and which is why we consume those things too. It's one of these cyclical things, and we are very comfortable with it. I am not going to question any of that. Even that comfort is something I feel. But then it should disturb me if my comfort is at the expense of somebody else. That is a basic ethical way of looking at our lives. When I said let's think of ourselves as Porambokku, I think the essential and the most core aspect of Porambokku is the idea of being empathetic to something that's greater than your need. But privilege does not somehow allow us to do it. And like Niti very, very beautifully put, the more privileged we are, the more scared we are. More than fear, it is also you feel that a favor is being done. Look at how much money is being spent. You forget that this is not a charitable organization. Let's be very clear. This is a business entity. They are making money. Nothing wrong with that. Please do. But nobody is doing charity here. It's not a favor they are doing to make sure that the shop is completely full of the shampoo that you require. No. And they don't need to do you that favor. But why do we have to feel emboldened towards them? That's something we should seriously think about. Because that's in all our psyche. And in doing that, we do something drastic. And I think something that is larger than even a Unilever conversation. Which is we've reduced ourselves in this room to mere consumers. Forget about Unilever, forget about Vedanta, forget about everybody else. Are we all just consumers of all this? Is there something else to us? Where is the idea of citizenship? Where is the idea? We raise our hands, Bharat Mata, whatever, sing our national anthem, talk about nationalism. But when you don't exercise the basic quality of citizenship, which is essentially in a democracy to ask difficult questions. Even if those questions are going to hurt you. And if there's anybody who can ask that question with at least less fear of being damaged, it's a privileged. But we're the worst at doing that. We're the worst. And I'll tell you something very odd. You know, even Niti spoke about, why are you asking Unilever the question? What happened to Tamil Nadu Control Board? What happened to the government of Tamil Nadu? Okay, I will put a wager here to every one of you in this room. Have all of you, at any point of time in your life, opened the newspaper, seen something that some corporate with whom you have no association has got some benefit from some government and said, oh, after all, he's such a big guy, he has so much money, of course he'll get this done. Haven't all of us sitting in this room said that at some point of time? When it's a corporate with whom we have no relationship, then we are happy to say the government is powerless. What to do? The corporate has so much money. What to do? He's going to influence. He has crores. But if it is a corporate with whom we have an association, then we will say, why should the corporate be held responsible? Let's ask them. Isn't there something problematic there? There is something problematic there. Let's recognize the problem. Don't have to agree with what I'm proposing, but recognize the problem. We all do it. I do it. I may question Unilever. I may not question somebody else. I am as guilty of this. I may sit here like a champion and talk to you, but I may tomorrow not question another company. Because today Unilever is something I am part of, I am part of the movement, therefore it's somewhere, it's become a bit personal. So we have to wonder about what is the idea of being a citizen? What is the idea of participating in a democratic conversation? And as privileged people, we have to ask that even more. Because unfortunately, we live in such an uneven society. Whether we like it or not, whether we believe that all these unevenness exists or not, it exists. So, before I say something more, I'm going to play a song, new song. This was the new song that we did. That was Kodaikanal Wont. This was Kodaikanal Still Wont.
And hopefully we won't be making another one.
Yeah, I really hope we won't, because I can tell you by the time we got this song done, we were really happy that it was done. So just listen to this song. Yeah. You got YouTube?
Yeah, I thought I queued it, but I
haven't. That's okay. Yeah, it's there.
Can we have the volume up, please?
This feels good.
Sorry.
Volume, please. Can you have volume up?
This is up.
So this song was filmed, I don't know what, in April of this year. And the reason for this song was what Nithyanand explained. The fact is that the place is not being cleaned up and is not going to be cleaned up as per international standards. And the song demands that Unilever takes the lead and does what is basically right.
Yeah, I mean, the volume is a bit low, so we'll continue to talk even though we have nothing much to say. No, okay. Actually the whole topic on racism.
Yeah, so this song speaks about the idea of racism, the idea that this is a form of environmental racism. Now, if you would have different standards with which you will clean up mercury from a soil, depending on where it is, then there is seriously a problem with the idea of that corporation. And it's not a small amount. The differences are huge. And this is an environmentally sensitive area. This is a residential area. For anybody who goes to Kodaikanal next time, you can actually walk down that road. You'll have to see beautiful houses on the right side, old houses. And just walk a little further and you will see the Unilever factory. It is not far away from people. It's right plonk there in the city. Are you getting it? Shall I go on?
Yeah.
Can we go on?
Yeah, we can go on.
I've always seen Murphy's Law like this applies in especially all these high-tech universities. I don't know what you guys are up to, but anyway. So, since you can't see the song, I hope you can see it at some point of time. So this song was released just a couple of months ago. Again, it's unfortunate at one level that people who are involved in social campaigning or environmental justice campaigning have to constantly do something. Have to constantly do something to make sure that people like us pay attention. And then we go to the next point. Why is it? Why is it? Irrespective of the company we're talking about. Yeah, can you pause it? I'll come back to it. Yeah, why is it irrespective of this of the company we talk about? The people affected by any such act, by any corporation, are people who don't matter to all of us. There is a pattern here. We can't miss the pattern. That whether it is what is happening in Thoothukudi, whether it is what is happening in Kodaikanal, the fact is who is being affected? Those who are socially marginalized in society, whose protests nobody is going to care about. In fact, it, you know, it's very uncomfortable at one level. I was talking to Nitin this morning that you need people like us to actually talk about this. Isn't it such a problem that we are not a society who listen to those voices? You need Nitin and Jayaram, TM Krishna to come to IIM Bangalore and speak to all of you. No, we shouldn't be that way. But the fact is we don't care if a worker from a factory from Kodaikanal talks about it. It is some little news. And what is worse is when people die, they become a numerical. Whether we agree with, let's look at Thoothukudi. Whether we have a, we can have 100 opinions about what happened, okay, about the factory issue. But it is 13 people who died. Or 15 people. This is a number. Just weigh that against the benefits of having a copper factory. Isn't that so ugly? Would any of us say that if 5 people in this room died? We wouldn't say that. We wouldn't say that. And we would hold the person or the company accountable. And so we have to wonder about the fundamental fact that somewhere when we find excuses for these things, we are actually acting with great insensitivity. That we are not behaving like Porambokas. Now I want you to just watch the song since the volume is back.
Just 1 minute.
You can use my mic. Where do you want to put it? Wait, wait, wait. Yeah, I'll do that. Go ahead, you go ahead. I'll do it.
Clean up right, clean the sight, clean the sight, we were white, clean up right.
So this was a song that we just released a few months ago. And I want to say something about this song. We talked about racism. And we immediately associate the fact that racism is about the purpose, the person who's perpetrating the, so the idea of white. The point is, it doesn't matter if the person perpetrating is black, white, or brown. Racism is an idea that is perpetrated by every one of us, not just the white person. So it's not a question of white person perpetrating racism, it's also all of us. It's also Unilever India that is also perpetrating this racism. So the idea is that racism is something that we all do, and it doesn't matter if the person is white, brown, black. We all do it. And that's what this questions. The fact that irrespective of whether the CEO of Unilever was a white Paul Pullman or an African American X or an Indian Y, the same thing would have happened. Because fundamentally, we do not treat people who live in the margins as equals of even all of us sitting in this room. I'd like to just finally end, taking a lot of your time, by again saying one thing. I think nobody is questioning the fact that Unilever makes products, gives a lot of money, gives a lot of jobs, supports education in many ways, and nobody is questioning all that. But you can't use that to buy people. That is something we should think about. That can't be an excuse to buy people off, that here all the good things happen, in some little corner of Kodaikanal this can happen. That is just ugly. I think if any of us here just spend some time thinking about it, we will see the intrinsic inequality and just wrongness, even if there is a word like that, about what is happening. And we have to think deeply about corporations. Nityananda already spoke about it. We have to think deeply about the constructions of corporations. Your management institute, you always are discussing ideas. I think if there's any place where these formations need to be challenged, they have to also come from places like here. Not just activists or people who have a certain different position. I think it has to come from here. The courage to question the way in which your students and professors make people for this country has to be questioned by people sitting in this room and in this campus. Because that's when I think this becomes an everyday discourse, even within corporations. If corporations have to change, then the people in corporations have to change. And if people in corporations have to change, I'm bluntly going to say, you have to change. But if you don't, then there are still going to be people dying. There are still going to be people in the margins we don't care about. There are still circus tricks that activists are going to keep trying to make and plea. Actually, this is not, you know, this gathering in some way is very sad. It's actually a very sad gathering that we have to come here and pitch in a way, you know, isn't it? Pitch in a way for something that is so inhuman. And I think I'm as disturbed by the fact that this has to be a pitch. That to do the right thing, we have to somehow sell something. And maybe in some ways I'm also being a producer and you're being a consumer. But that's not the way these discussions should occur. They should occur at a slightly more, I think, mature level. And I do hope all of you just think about the points that we made today. And these are not things that you can just say 10 years later, let me get to a position where I can talk about all this. No, it'll never happen. As a person who, for some reason, got involved in social and cultural and environmental discourses, I can tell you that day will never happen unless you make a proactive action to make this happen. And Unilever is an example of a place I think we all can start, because Unilever is anyway bigger than all of us here. Okay, much bigger than all of us here. That's the easiest reason why we should start. Thank you.
So just two very quick things. Before we open for questions, one of the last thing that Krishna said, that people will keep dying in the margins. I don't think it's people dying in the margins. There's I just gone for a talk in Chennai about the future of development. I don't think there is a future for this development. And what you call growth is a biological concept. So things are born, they grow, and they die. The only place where death doesn't happen is in economics, where things just continue to grow, and we have extremely erudite people who subscribe to this. So the question of, we need to question the erudition itself. But there's one of those economists, a guy called Thomas Piketty, that you might have heard of. The main danger with extreme inequality is that if you don't solve this through peaceful and democratic institutions, then it will be solved in other ways. And that is extremely frightening. What happened in Thoothukudi was essentially that. Where was CII for 22 years? Where is CII for the last 35 years in Bhopal? What have they said? Where is the business community talking about this? Where is their sense of responsibility? Where is IIM saying anything about it? What is IIM's take on Vedanta? Not just on whether the company should be closed or not. That's a no-brainer. You guys will say, yes, it's open. It should be closed. It should be open. The question is, what about the 22 years? Let's talk about the middle ground. The middle ground is what happened in the 22 years. Who is now? I mean, you have all kinds of babas talking about reopening the companies. Nobody has yet said anything about investigating the complaints about illnesses in that area, talking about water for the people. These are our people. There are no non-our people. Everybody is our people. Then where is that conversation happening? Are we here only to defend the big corporations? They don't need your defense. They've got people paid to do that. Where do you stand? So I would actually invite you to think about this. There is a sign-up sheet. This sign-up sheet is not a boycott Unilever sign-up sheet. It is I will think sign-up sheet. So if you are up to thinking about this, and you can think in whichever way you want, there's not going to be a name-calling, you know, propaganda stuff. I have a point of view. I would like to engage. I come here because you guys will have a lot more meaning. I go there and collect 200,000 signatures, and I have one IIM person thinking. It rattles Unilever. Because Unilever does not want you to think. If you think, that threatens them. So I'm saying think. Because by threatening them, maybe I'm wrong, and corporations can be reformed. But that reform will only happen if you think. I don't think they can be reformed, but that's my point of view. If you think they can be reformed, it is not going to happen by you sitting quiet. Ask the tough questions. So, sign up sheet for I will think. It's called something else. It says, interested in discussing Unilever's Kodaikanal legacy. I've kept it as bland and non-activisty as I possibly could. So, yeah, we are open for questions, comments.
Because Unilever produces both all these beauty products and which involve racist aspirations on the part of the consumers, and simultaneously is a thermometer, but at this point my question is more about the thermometer, because thinking about it, here is a product that has killed people in Kodaikanal, but I dare say the thermometer has also saved a lot of lives. So the question is more to launch a more focused campaign. It's a bit of a coincidence in producing both these products to some extent. Okay. So the first point is, have the same safety standards for mercury as you had there. And I was just curious, what is the cost of a thermometer? I have no idea.
They don't only India be making for some export.
Okay.
Mercury thermometers have been largely phased out, including in India. They moved to digital thermometers.
So
The issue, as you said, is yes, safe standards, no double standards, makes a lot of sense. Thermometer came into Unilever's portfolio by accident. It was not intentional. They got it in the basket of things that they got the Ponds factory. So, of course, Ponds, they took it for obvious reasons. And this medical division was one of it. Also, oftentimes, when the business is not the mainstay, there is less attention paid to it because they are the kind of the neglected porumbokes of the business realm. And so there is less attention paid to safety. The management is not really looking at that place. And so a lot of things happen, bad things happen.
So, I mean, in a sense, then you can move for a ban on working with thermometers and say only digital thermometers. I mean, that would be...
That is already happening. That is already happening. There's a phase out. There's an international convention to which, called Minamata Convention, to which India is signatory, and not just mercury thermometers, but fluorescent lamps and a lot of other places, switches and things that mercury is in. And there is a effort to phase it out. And of course, in the phase out effort, the manufacturers who use it will fight, and there'll be other people who fight back. But the fight is extremely unequal. But that is on the way. Right now, what we're talking about is
a very simple thing. There is a legacy issue in Kodaikanal. And the legacy issue needs to be taken up.
And for the legacy issue, long-haired, ponytailed people speaking does not help.
You need to have
the suits speak.
And when the suits speak, it's heard. And it's not as if the courts and suits
don't have a point of view. I think they can make it far more forcefully and articulately than anybody else. And possibly also in a language that is acceptable to them. So I think that needs to happen. Why it's not happening is because the job of social change is being outsourced. Activists are not the outsourcing agents for, you know, the people to take on these things. It needs to be something that everybody needs to be involved in some way or the other. Opposing, you know, for whatever, but on, you know, taking up positions. From IIM. How many people from IIM?
Okay, less than half.
More than half, I would say. Wait, one second, he just has a question if you don't mind.
Okay.
Yeah, I have a couple of points actually. So first of all, I'm completely with the cause that, and I congratulate you for having fought this cause for a long time. There are two things that I find problematic, to be frank. The first being that the second song that you showed, which said, treat us like we were white. I understand where you're coming from, but treat us like we were white has connotations, especially in India, which go well beyond what I think you are implying. To some extent, I think treat us like we were white is one reason why we were colonized in the first place. Treat us like we were white is probably why tourist towns still sometimes discriminate, Indians discriminate against Indians and have so-called white-only hotels, and I can go on and on. I was a little disappointed with all this in mind. I was a little disappointed with your choice of wording. My second point is, again, I'm not sure if this thermometer factory was reporting to Unilever worldwide or a part of Hindustan Unilever. I'm assuming it's the latter. We see that a lot of multinational companies in India have somebody from the head office usually here as part of XYZ India. That doesn't seem to be the case with Unilever, I just checked. And my intuition is that racism is one person treats two people differently. So if I was in a plane and an air hostess treated me differently from a white person, that would be racism. What I think is happening here is that we are being, there's a kind of capture of the government, and essentially, maybe there is an element of racism, and you're much better to comment on that. But what is happening is that our own people have taken advantage of a lax political system and a lax regulatory system, and we are getting the shorter end of the stick.
So I will kind of take the second question and let Krishna take the first question.
Yes, just finish, please.
It's related.
Sure, please.
First takeaway for me in this is that music can be a very powerful communication medium to change things. And that's a very good thing. However, as my friend here was mentioning, the mistake of Unilever is acquiring Teesboro Farms. Teesboro Farms was the one which was doing this factory, and the factory under Teesboro Farms was there from 1983 to 1998 or so when Unilever acquired it. Okay? So before that, it was a different kind of mistake. Now, we say the moment it was done, the factory was closed. And now for the last 10 years we are talking about remedying the situation. Factory was anyway closed. Now, coming to your double standards, I was just looking at the figures. UK is 1 milligram per kg, US is 5 point some milligrams per kg. So how does that stand in double standards? Is that also a double standard? So the question is, different countries have different standards. Poor countries have a laxer standard. Because there is always a trade-off between, you know, benefits and costs, environmental costs and economic benefits. There's always a trade-off.
Human cost too.
Human costs, yes, no doubt. Of course, we sometimes get emotional, but then in the larger scheme of things, it will reduce to another. Now, in that case, I would say, if we accepted 20 milligram per kg, should I blame Hindustan or Unilever, or should I blame our government? The same question for Union Carbide also. The important point is, in both cases, what was not acceptable in US was put in a developing country. Therefore, as he rightly said, capture of the government is much more important. Our government is not representing us. Even in terms of getting the money for compensation, our government betrayed us in the case of Union Carbide. So, when there is the elephant in the room, are we getting selectively going after this? That's the
question. So, I will just answer a couple of questions that he raised and also the question that you asked for. Krishna will take on the first one about racism. I'll just make a brief mention. This is something that came up in discussions. It was a call that we took. We take responsibility for the call. And we knew that this would come up. And so we tried to do that by putting those sarcasm, that cute word that we put over there in italics. Did you notice that? Okay, yeah. And you know, for many, including other very, very good friends. Yeah. Yeah, right. So, but then the word sarcasm next to white was put there saying, you know, this is a tongue-in-cheek way of saying it. I think that it did not work. There are other people who have said it, and I think that we can just only take responsibility for it because it is primarily a lyrical judgment that is made, and there was also this whole thing. So, I'm sorry that we disappointed you, but yeah, there was a judgment call. He will take a crack on that as well. I will answer the other questions that you talked about, which is India or Unilever India, Hindustan Unilever or Unilever PLC. This Unilever PLC that acquired Chesbrough Ponds, and the Ponds India Limited came into the basket of Hindustan Unilever. Sir is right in that between 1983 and 1998, Unilever was not the owner, but had a significant share already in the operations in Ponds India Limited. Incidentally, between 1998 and 2001 is where the entire 400 tons went out in breach of established procedures. So it is not as if when Unilever walked in, automatically things changed or they just inherited a lemon. It is not true. There are many things that Unilever could have done when they were there. It's not a matter of whether it's Unilever or Chesbrough Ponds. I think both of them would have behaved exactly the way they did, because Kodaikanal is Kodaikanal, India is India, and Mercury is Mercury, and their business is their business, and nobody can ask them. So it does not matter whether it's Unilever or Chesbrough Ponds. I'm not selective. As I said, I'm an anti-corporate activist. I would like to see all corporations abolished. So not all selective. Unilever just happens to be a case in point that I'm using to demonstrate this. The second issue is, so between 1998 and 2001 is when all the violations in terms of the environmental discharges, in terms of bulk, in moving the broken thermometers out and dumping it in various places. On whether, this is something that Dow Chemical has also talked about in Union Carbide, and I see this trope coming up in Unilever, as well as we acquired towards the tail end. When you acquire something, you acquire the assets and the liabilities. You can't just say, I want the assets, I'm not responsible for the liabilities. You have acquired it, you went in with your eyes wide open, you felt that this will not come back to bite you, and I don't think it has come back to bite them, because they're doing perfectly well. Their image has not suffered a dent at all. 3 years in the double standard. The thing about double standards in US and UK. So the way, since it's a slightly more complicated question, asking how standards are established. The residential standard, these are all called guideline values. Guideline values are the values, so if I'm going to take a residential property, in that residential property, will I be given, if I take a property and want to build a house on it, I would have to get a planning permission, I have to get a zoning permission at that time. They do a test, and if it's more than 1 milligram per kilogram, they will say this is not fit for residential area in UK. In remediation of contaminated sites. Contaminated sites are remediated with keeping in mind the future use of that site. This factory site is located in an ecologically contiguous area to the Kodaikanal Wildlife Sanctuary. There is a fence that divides the factory from the Kodaikanal Wildlife Sanctuary. In environment, fences don't mean anything. So ecologically, it's one contiguous piece. So when you set a target level for remediation, there is something called intervention value. And intervention value is the value at which you intervene. Intervention is required. That value might be as high as 36 milligrams per kilogram. If I find 36 milligrams of mercury in the soil, in 1 kilogram of soil, I have to intervene to reduce it. How much will I reduce it to? I will reduce it depending upon the use. If it's future industrial use, I don't expect children to be running around hand-to-mouth behavior, so I can have a much laxer standard for a future industrial use. Residential use, slightly more stringent. And ecological areas, ecologically sensitive areas like this one, super stringent, because mercury behaves badly in water. So in this instance, what we're saying is the very fact that you haven't taken the residential value is wrong. When you're calculating your site-specific target level, you do a risk analysis, and what is your risk receptor matters the most. If you're assuming the risk receptor to be a fully grown white adult male, then the amount of stuff that person can take is very different from what a puny child in India could, or the ecosystem receptors could. So that's the second point. We're talking about trade-offs and benefits. In fact, in 2001, Unilever's consultant, URS Dames and Moore, the guy that did that jugglery of mass balance, that reputed company, proposed a cleanup standard of 10 milligrams per kilogram. And we made a noise saying 10 milligrams is a very lax residential standard. You need to look at ecosystem levels. So we were shut up, it was taken out. Within 3 years, the same standard was not the same standard. The standard was diluted to 20. From 10, it became 20. And this is Neary proposing this new standard of 20, saying they have looked at it, and considering the techno-commercial benefits to the company, the level has been reduced, the standard has been diluted from 10 to 20. How do I care what techno-commercial benefits are for the company? If you're talking about a trade-off, I get something good, I lose something. That is okay. The company gets something good, we lose. That is considered to be a trade-off? In which language? That is not the trade-off you're talking about. I don't think that's the trade-off that you are talking about. You're talking about public good versus whatever public expenditure. But in this instance, this is what happened. There was a trade-off. That trade-off was for the company and against us. And this trade-off is called an externality. I'm sure you guys have heard about that. Externality means externalizing to the workers, to the community, to the environment, to future generations, to your shareholders, and to your consumers. The best companies tend to externalize beautifully. It's an externalizing machine, and they do it ideally without getting caught. Trade-on access standards is fine, then TNPCB. The question about TNPCB, the government captures captured by whom? I'm saying it's been captured by the likes of Unilever, the corporations. They control the world governments, and I'm unable to break it because there are not enough people who are ready to challenge it. Our democracy is only a notional democracy. You vote somebody who will work for somebody else. That is what is happening.
Yeah, so I think just carrying on from the question is, who is the elephant in the room is the question.
I think that's the question. Because, as you put in, you also suggested, the fact is, yeah, of course, we all know, like he said, the government is captured. There is a problem in the way we frame our thing. But the question is, who is actually the elephant who's able to capture it? The fact of the matter is, even the Indian government is not equal to the United States government, is it? Is the relationship of Unilever with the United States government going to be the same as Unilever with India, or Unilever with the government in Rwanda? This is an unequal relationship straight away. So while we have to raise fingers on our government, on our pollution control board, and I must say that has not been happening. So I don't want to get the presumption that protests have not gone to the pollution control board, RTI's appeals are not happening, all this is also happening. But if you want any of these people to really respond, you have to actually target the elephant in the room, the elephant that we are not willing to talk about. And that elephant is Unilever. That's precisely the point. And to your question, well, this was a word that we debated hell of a lot. Even before the video came out, I think Aramanitya and I going back and forth on this whole idea. So what will white connote? How will it be understood? And we had a certain reason why it was there. One was artistic. The other idea was also to play with the idea that Unilever sells a cream that wants to make you white. Okay? So it's a kind of a pun on that. That you want us to look white, but you won't treat us like you would treat people in your country. Okay? And like I said, it's not about whether Unilever is white or not. It's about the idea of white. But I also get what you're saying, that this very easily can mean, yeah, I completely agree. Yeah, go ahead.
I'll actually go back to a completely different article that was written by you about Dalits wearing the punal.
Yeah.
See, the problem here is treat me with dignity cannot be equated with treat me like a Brahmin, right?
Absolutely.
And I would actually draw a parallel here.
Yeah, I completely agree. There is a problem there. But the problem was also because it was a campaign point. Okay? It's also a campaign point. This was the reason why this video came out. So there was a campaign agenda to this video. And which is why the play of white was a problematic play, but it was play. And I, like Nikhil said, we take the responsibility that we play. And like you said, if you compare it to the position that I personally, for example, still take on the idea of the punal and on what happened in Kerala, yes, if you look at it two together, yes. But the point was, this was a campaign, and this had an audience. The campaign that had an audience, and we were hitting an audience. We're hoping that the audience who hopefully will respond to it in some fashion would understand it in that sense. Which is why we also added the sarcasm in that, because we realize people not only figure that it's sarcastic, you take it literally, it's even worse, right? So, but I get what you're saying, and I get the little knot that there exists in it. But like I said, it was part of musical, and also part of campaign strategy on hoping that the big bosses of Unilever would see it in that campaign angle and find it problematic for them for other reasons.
And the fact that it's raising this conversation, it's doing its job, right?
It was a rhetorical strategy.
Yeah, I mean, it's a strategy, like I said, but I have to take his point also. Because it is an important point, because it's something that we also debated. In fact, the day before the video went out, we were on the phone for 2 hours discussing this whole point. I mean, it's a problem. How do we deal with this problem? We already shot the video. We actually went back and forth on this for almost 2 hours and said, okay, it's a strategy, but it can very well be also a problem. And we have to accept that there is that angle to it.
Thank you for bringing this topic to our attention. Right? I apologize if I'm not completely coherent, because this is a topic that I'm passionate about, and your videos have made me a little anxious. Right? This is not the only country in which these things have happened. Right? If you look at any large corporation, this is what they do. Bayer goes and sells HIV-tainted blood after knowing that it has HIV in South Africa, so that they can make profit out of it. Nestle encourages mothers to stop breastfeeding their kids and to give them formula milk, therefore killing millions of children for making a very small, tidy sum that they want. So this happens all across the globe. Right? Here the difference is, in India we have this veneration problem where we think that these companies are doing us a favor by taking money from us. Thank you for taking money from us, and that is why we have to really worship you. That is a problem. I don't have any problem with the words that you've used in any one of your videos. I think, you know, we are missing the real issue here. Right? If we need to address a problem, right, there are a few things which are required. One, it has to be very clear. Right? It can't be a diffuse, all-encompassing problem. Right? If you want to change something, it has to be specific. That has to be changed. This switch has to be turned on or off. If you have to do everything, it kind of gets overwhelming and people don't respond as well to it. So here, I'm going to look specifically at this Kodaikanal issue. I don't really want to talk about regulatory capture. Indian government is not any less weaker than the US government. If you look at who heads the EPA, who heads the FDA, all of these are ex-directors and vice presidents of Monsanto and all these companies who are going there. Regulatory capture is a worldwide phenomenon. We are no different. If we are going to address this issue, we have to speak to Unilever in a language that it understands. If you want the politician to change, we have to speak in a language that the politician understands. Hit them only where it hurts. Everywhere else, they are guarded. They have vajra kavacha, right? So for the politicians, what matters to them is publicity about anything. Same thing for corporations. Corporations, publicity is the first level, the second level is money. If it affects their money, they're going to stop doing anything. You can't really expect great success of a boycott of a company that manufactures 1,000 different products. It gets overwhelming, right? A boycott, I don't know if it will really be the best way ahead. But what is the best way ahead is to get the attention of these companies by getting hold of these key people who hold a lot of mass opinion. For instance, Snapchat, when it released its updates, there was huge outcry that nobody wanted these updates, right? It's a very trivial example, I mean. But the moment Rihanna tweeted once that she's not going to use it until this nonsense redesign has to be done. Not only was it changed, the CEO was threatened to be fired if he doesn't change. One celebrity tweeting, right? Why is this offensive person sitting in the US president's office so successful? Because he has this one small talent, and that is having these shameful tweets. He coins these short phrases that gets repeated very quickly, right? And these shameful phrases are what, you know, go viral. A song is huge. For me to be able to repeat or refer to something so that it becomes understandable, I need a short phrase, a hashtag, which is very shameful and detrimental to the good image of the company that it has developed. I think that is where we find the good part, the conscientious part of the world not good at. Right? the water in Flint, Michigan has been contaminated for so many years now. Nothing has been done, despite protests, despite dharnas there in the same United States and Michigan, the same state. Right? Yet, if there is one tweet done saying, you know, I'm going to challenge you to fix this, Elon Musk steps in and says, okay, I'm going to fix this. And that has shamed the government in saying, okay, and now I'm going to step in. We need to shame these people. And shame them by hurting where it, you know, means something to them. Not, you know, having songs, I don't know if it will really capture them. I'm glad that the first song worked, but that is greenwashing, right? You put in a facade where you say that I'm going to do these things, and then 10 years later you do 1/1,000,000th of it and go around saying that I did something.
So yeah, so I just very quickly talk to you from the actor's perspective is that there are really no blueprints. And the other unfortunate thing is that there's not a single thing that we cannot afford to ignore, that is not do. You campaign on the streets, you campaign in the courts, you campaign in the outside the pollution control board, inside the pollution control board, inside Unilever, friendly with Unilever, angry with Unilever, all those places have to be occupied. The capacity might not be there, but that is what grassroots globalization does. Second, in terms of whether the song works or tweet works, as I said, there's 20% work and 80% magic. Or 80% money. We don't have the money, so we need magic. So be it a tweet or a song, the second song bombed. The first song flew. We had no control over either the flying or the bombing. We just did the song and put it out there. We were all dressed up. Right now, we are dressed up, ready to party. There's no party happening. We have all the information. So if the song had done its job, Mr. Polman would be saying, what do we do now? And we have everything that needs to be said. But nobody's asking us what needs to be done because the issue is not made, the power dynamics have not changed. Like you said, maybe a tweet, I think that's something we can definitely, any ideas, definitely we'll take. There's nothing we can say, oh no, this won't work because we don't know what will work. And this sounds like a very good idea, we will definitely try that.
Can I just add something? The question is, who's a celebrity? I'm going to raise that question here.
And one more thing. One last thing is that while there is a tactical need to address the issue of Kodaikanal, we are very much looking at the diffuse thing. I'm saying my job is, what I'm looking at is in my vision for what is a sustainable future, what would be good for children. These are things that actually preoccupy my mind. There a corporation doesn't have a role to play. So I need to find out ways to dismantle it. Those are diffuse ideas. These are ideas that are being sold. I never dreamed that I'd be inside Indian Institute of Management, Bangalore, saying, break down the corporation. It feels really good to say it, so I'll say it one more time. Let's break down the corporation. But, yeah, so I'm just saying that putting these out are very important. They're very diffuse. How do I go break down the corporation? But the idea is there, and ideas matter. And that is why there's a diffuse part of it. The other part of it is the tactical thing, what happens in Kodaikanal. I am slightly... I mean, while we do use, as I said, we do use celebrity, for the thing, but then it is also which celebrity that we use. That is one. Second is, this activism cannot be outsourced to celebrities. What we are saying is we need to create democratic space where the people who matter need to matter. And how can that happen? It doesn't make sense for me to create democratic space and occupy it with what I have to say. So how do you create those spaces? Forget the easy questions. Easy questions anybody can answer. We want you to give us help with the more difficult questions. How do I make this diffuse campaign more focused?
Yeah, and I want to add this whole idea of a celebrity. I think the question is, who is a celebrity? And which celebrity will hurt? Now for corporations like Unilever, IIM Bangalore is a celebrity. Not just Rahana or somebody else. So you will also hurt Unilever if you may take a stand, or if you even ask the question, forget about stand. If IIM Bangalore will ask the question, I can tell you Unilever will come running tomorrow. Because niche intellectual elitism is also something corporations love. Because you are the place that they will invest in, you are the place they will take out from. They need you. But the unfortunate thing is you think you need them more than they need you. That's the problem, right? It's a mindset issue. But if I am Bangalore, I am Ahmedabad, we'll ask the question of Unilever, what are you doing to these people? Nobody, again, I agree with you that boycott is probably the most ridiculous way to think about it. You know, it's utter stupidity, okay? But asking questions of people, so it's not just the cinema stars or the Hollywood, Bollywood people who are celebrities. I am Bangalore is a celebrity. The institution is a celebrity. You're willing to wear that badge when you hunt for jobs and say, I'm an IIMB graduate. Why won't you wear the same badge and ask this question?
Yeah. I have two parts question to ask. First is, what happened to all the mercury that has been taken away from Kodaikanal? Is it being dumped in another third world country?
No, that's a beautiful part.
Where is it?
So, in 2001, factory shut down, and we thought we had won. We didn't know that we had just like inherited an 18, God knows how long, another 30 years of struggle. But in 2001, the place was looked at. They contained it using men in suits. And then we insisted it has to leave the country. Where should it go? It should go to United States of America because that's where the story began. And again, we shouted, but we didn't have to shout very hard. There was a very able administrator, the Pollution Control Board, that usually happens once in a lifetime. My quota is over. We've seen that one good woman there. And she said, okay, fine. Can it be sent? I said, yes, it can be sent. Is it not toxic trade? No, it's not toxic trade. There's something called Basel Convention. It allows for bilaterals. So for the first time in the history of the world, garbage flowed in the reverse direction. Garbage usually flows from places where rich people live to where poor people live. In India, it's also kind of, you know, negotiated by caste. Globally, it flows from rich countries to poor countries. That is the only way. It is almost like, you know, your water flows from high to low. This time it moved from Kodaikanal to Tutukudi and on a ship all the way to Pennsylvania, and went to a place called Bethlehem Apparatus, which was an original supplier of the mercury.
The second part of the question is, you mentioned about this lady officer who was responsible for this, right? Can you explain the circumstance after this question, the circumstances that happened that led to this decision? Because this overall meeting today, like you all mentioned, that we are privileged here in some sense, and we may be heard loud if we say something, but I feel if you appeal to the ethics of the officer in the ground, it's more, more direct than appealing to us here.
No, I think
because it's that lady who decided all this.
No, you're right. But then the appealing to the ethics happens when there's ethics there. Then we appeal and it
happens. There was someone, right? At least one person did it, right?
No, there are many people. I'm not, don't get me wrong at all. It is not as if Tamil Nadu bureaucracy has only that one person.
Exactly.
There are many people that are silently doing stuff. What we need to realize is who are those people? And be able to support them because they come under tremendous pressure. So yes, I mean, I think that definitely strengthening the hands of those who speak out and who have the courage to actually, you know, do the right thing. Yes.
Then, just to add there, then please put that lady officer's picture and name in your PPTs from now onwards.
I will ask her. Yeah, sure.
But I told you the name.
You can check it. Just do Google images. If you have Google Dada is there, they'll help you with everything. Sheila Rani Chunkat.
So I have a question on, you're talking about how one video, you know, hits and the other one doesn't. So my question was on a similar line, like how we see that certain environmental activism, you know, kind of hits, like if you talk about Nimgiri Vedanta, although there was a angle of religion of the tribes and other thing, and it also gave a larger question of thinking about tribal forest rights and everything, but eventually it brought a larger picture, and there was it did take a lot of steps, you know, it was a success. We kind of lack a federalism where we had a people in Tuticorin who failed to think about Nimgiri people, but they were at the same stand, they had to fight a Vedanta in Tuticorin. I think you'll be able to answer why we, you know, fail at this, like certain environmental activism kind of takes. If you take even a small example, like even the 800 trees in Bangalore for a steel bridge, all that we had was a few social activism under two celebrities and people. That kind of was a hit, but whereas in certain places it doesn't.
No, so I think that a lot of things that happen on social activism are invisible to people whose main source of information, for most of us, the main source of information is newspapers and television. They don't cover this. Tuticorin got a lot of solidarity from Niamgiri, from Korba, from Odisha, other parts, from the mining areas in Chhattisgarh. So, and likewise, and Goa, and likewise, there have been exchanges. So about 8 years ago, there was a meeting in Salem where all people who are affected by Vedanta from all communities actually came together, looking at how one can strengthen each other's struggle, because Thoothukudi is being projected as a abnormality. It's not. It is the, if anything, you cannot blame Vedanta for inconsistency. They apply the same standards everywhere in the developing world. And so people do come together. In fact, our biggest strength is grassroots globalization, as I said. The problem is oftentimes we are unable to penetrate the media to reach out to other people to let them know that such things are happening. The parallels between Niamgiri and Thoothukudi is in both places. Wherever companies like this operate, and extractive industries are far more violent than the likes of Unilever. In these places, the state turns against the people. In Niamgiri, Lado Sikaka and his nephew, both of them are tribal elders from the Dongriakol community, were taken, brutally beaten. Until then, they were primitive tribes. They don't call themselves primitive tribes, we call them that. They call themselves Dongriakon. Until then, they were Dongriakon primitive tribes, and overnight they became Naxalites. They were taken, hung upside down and tortured. That was the price of their victory. In Thoothukudi, I wouldn't even call it a victory. In Thoothukudi, 15 deaths, and the company's not gone yet. They will not give up without a fight. They will try to come back by hook or crook. And so the fight is not over there at all. And regardless of that, nobody's talking about cleanup of the place, rehabilitation of the people who have been affected, etc. Still, there's a state of repression there. Just day before yesterday, on the 22nd, we wanted to release the People's Inquest report into what happened in the 100 days of strike. Things are so vicious that the police cancelled, the police basically threatened the hall owner, the marriage hall owner. The marriage hall owner withdrew his permission. The next day, we got DMK's hall, Kalingir Hall. And the Kalingir Hall, last minute, they said, please go get a permission from the police and come. For an event inside a private premises, I mean, would you get a permission for this meeting? But there's a good possibility that things can move to that kind of a normal. And in Thoothukudi, that's what happened. The DMK hall was refused, and finally a church hall was being used for the event. The people, the victims' families who were supposed to come for this were personally visited by police and told not to go. Every village had 30 people videographing and telling them that if you go, we will file FIRs against you. So this is the kind of a condition under which an environmental fight is fought. No, I think if you can learn fast Fourier transforms, you can understand this stuff. So it's a matter of educating. So what you said is perfectly right. I'm not saying that you need to go out there and take a position. You're not ready to take a position yet. If you're not ready to take a position yet, definitely you need to be, because it is very important to be convinced about the position that you've taken. And so for that, you need to have discussions amongst yourself. I've come, Krishna has come, we have set our pitch. We have said our bit. We have said what we want to. And as I said, please sign up to think. And the thinking can happen the best way that it happens in educational institutions, so to have your discussions. Talk about this, what it means for this. Leave alone doing something for them. I'm saying that a lot of times, you are the victims. you guys are kind of stuck because you probably have paid a lot of money to come and work over here. So you can't take very hardcore positions, even though you feel that way, because you have to, return on investment is required. So one thing is to just figure out how to liberate oneself by, one, in this particular issue, what are the dilemmas, as a case in point. What are the dilemmas? You can be educated. Look at Unilever's website. They will talk about what their point of view is. Look at what's there in other websites. There's a kodaimercury.org, which is a website that the campaign has put up. Has a lot of information that is scientific. You can, if you have the energy to, go and visit Kodaikanal. And check out these things. If it might not be Kodaikanal, it might be something locally in your town. So yes, it is very possible for a bunch of bright people like you to educate yourself on something like this.
Can I just add something to the dilemma you're talking about? And you know, as being as privileged as you are, I think the first step in my own journey, I'm speaking personally here, is to first recognize that and recognize that you're part of the problem. That this is not somebody else's drudgery or pain or suffering that you want to understand and go and help. But I think if there is that whole acceptance that you're a participant in it, and you're, like you said, both a victim and probably a perpetrator in that very odd sense of the term, I think that itself is a way in which you'll start engaging with, it could be Unilever, whatever it is, whatever issues it is. For me, that was the first point, to see that I am part of it, that I'm not here because I'm doing something or I'm helping people, because that mode itself places you beyond the problem. That's fundamentally, constructionally, very, very ethically problematic, because you're saying there's a problem there, I'm there viewing the problem, I'll understand the problem and I'll help it. But if you say the problem is all of us, if Unilever can behave this way, in some way I'm part of that, then I think that takes us in a different way of understanding the issue. And the participation doesn't stop with the Unilever issue or the next change.org sign up that you've got on your email. Become slightly more.
Thanks for the presentation. It was very, very powerful. The placement chair was here. I don't know what we will do, but hopefully we will do something. My question is this. Is it even possible to clean this up? Because it's not as if the mercury is only sitting in the soil. It's all over in the water, right? And it's all over in the forest as well. So how do you clean something like that up? I'm not saying Unilever should not, but I'm just wondering, how do you clean something like that up?
So there's 1.3 tons that's gone into the forest. Nothing can be done about it. That we have to face the effects of it. And we can do monitoring to see if the levels are building up in the forest. Because what happens is mercury has a certain kind of dynamic of moving, which is not very well understood. But if we try to understand that, then we can have early warning to prevent, for instance, now we found that there are fish in the plains that are contaminated at a high level, where sufficient to cause frequent meals, fish meals. So in such cases, you can't really clean it up because you have very small amounts of mercury that tend to build up. So in those areas, what you can do is put out advisories saying, fish from this pond, not for consumption. It's a kind of a cop-out, but there's really nothing much you can do about it. What is inside the factory premises is the one that is leaking out. So the factory is heavily contaminated.
And from the factory, as I said, it's
from a slope. So with every passing rain, the groundwater takes soil-bound mercury into the Pambarshola. The factory premises can be cleaned.
But
to what extent?
They were not cleaned? You said the mercury was taken away from
the factory. This is the broken thermometers that was dumped over there, were taken away. And some of the other gross mercury storage that are stored inside the factory was taken out. They had also buried mercury in the in different places inside the factory. They had dumped it and buried it. So workers said that we know where it is.
So that was pointed
out. That was excavated and sent out. Now the soil itself is a toxic waste. If you have more than 36 milligrams per kilogram, it becomes a toxic waste, intervention value. So the soil itself is a toxic waste, and that soil needs to be cleaned up. It can be cleaned up. There are good ways of cleaning up and there are bad ways of cleaning up. You can clean it up very well without any dag left, like Surf Excel does, or you can do a pretty bad job of it. And here what they're saying is Surf Excel and Domex will not leave a stain behind, but mercury cleanup in Kodaikanal will leave a stain behind, because it just is not, techno-commercial viability is a problem, especially the commercial viability. Technical viability is there. In terms of expenses, For Unilever, it's pocket change. It's not likely to be very high. So it is not something that will punish them at all, at least not adequately.
I just want to say one thing. When they settled the workers, there was no admission of responsibility.
No admission.
I think we should say that also. So the whole thing was secrecy, settlement. Unilever never said it did anything wrong. I think that's also something we should put on the table when we have this.
In fact, the website says everything has been cleaned up.
Yeah.
There isn't an issue.
No. I think they are saying that they will be remediating the site to 20 milligrams.
Yes.
Yeah.
It has started now.
They had a trial. So I will tell you a little bit about the trial. The trial consists of a few processes. You dig out the soil, that's the excavation. You wash the soil. The theory being, mercury will bind very tightly to the fine particles. So you have to remove the fine particles. To do that, you wash the soil and sieve it. When you wash the soil, when mercury comes in contact with water, it has a weird thing of volatilizing. So by that, you clean up the soil by allowing some of the mercury to escape into the air. Then you are supposed to sieve it and remove the, concentrate the mercury in the fine fraction. So your sieving has to be very good and the finer fraction has to be filter pressed. And the anticipation is that all the mercury, majority of the mercury will be in this filter press cake. Majority of mercury will come out of the filter press cake. 50% of the mercury went out in the water into Pambashola. What was washed, they expected the coarser fractions to have less than 20 milligrams per kilogram. 50% of their samples failed to achieve that. Then the filter press cakes were supposed to be put inside an oven and heated, and the mercury was supposed to be recovered. They did 10 trials, 9 bombed, 1 was partially successful. This was considered to be a success by the scientific experts committee, and a permission was given to upscale this disaster to the entire site. So just by out of a total of what we had calculated, close to 7 kilograms out of 14 kilograms of mercury that was there in the soil that they tested with, 7 kilograms was discharged into the Pambashola or into the air. This was considered a success only in India. And how did that happen? Does it capture? The scientific experts committee is neither scientific nor an expert. They lack a spine and therefore they've done this. The only thing they have saving them is a PhD. Yeah. No. No, there are traces of mercury in drinking water, but your exposure route is not through drinking water because the levels are very small. But small levels of mercury in drinking water become a concern when there is fish from that area that is caught. Because you might not be able to detect it in the water medium. You'll be able to detect small amounts in the sediment and higher amounts as you go up the food chain. But so far the drinking water things have all come out without any concern, levels of concern. Yeah.
Well, I'm supportive of this campaign to, you know, clean up and if necessary ban HUL. I mean, we can't say yes, okay, I can try to fucking say HUL should be banned from some animals to clean up and I'm willing to do that. But I think in a much bigger issue of anti-corporation activism and so on, I think honestly we have a very naive view of how economy works as well as, I mean, and this whole thing unfortunately got mixed up with this racism and fair and lovely because it's a conglomerate. Exxon Valdez did a massive spill and they were made to pay to clean up. So similarly, they have spilled mercury, they have to be made to clean up. So it's a very specific issue. On the separate issue of should safety standards be the same in India as in US, as my colleague Professor Ranganathan said, it's as if that, see, it's one thing to say that they've hidden the information, that's different. But the question is through a democratic process, through voting and so on, I mean, there should be some scope for people to evolve some kind of safety standards. I mean, practice is a very different issue because, firstly, I don't see, I don't have this villain theory of the corporation, okay? And in a sense, I think more people die of drinking thara in India which is not made by multinationals, I mean, whatever booze they make is usually pretty safe, than by multinational products. So please keep that in mind to begin with. A corporation is just one type of entity. And the multinational as some Goda entity was there in the past. And in terms of regulatory capture, I think Ambani has a much stronger hold,
certainly,
the government of India, than a foreign multinational.
Certainly.
They're unfortunately, even different things are getting mixed up in this.
Okay,
and
so
if you want a one-point agenda of, say, if they don't clean up, ban them from IIM, fine, I'll sign that. Okay. Now, in terms of more constructive approach, we can say, okay, all these people spend on corporate social responsibility. Ask the whole of corporate India to say, and much of their money goes to NGOs and it goes to hiring people with degrees in NGOs from, you know, various places, even IIM, even data engineering, social sciences. So let all that money be spent directly for this one, you know. But just keep in mind, and in fact, even when a corporation doesn't do something by stealth or this, people will migrate from a village and willing to, because, you know, when people are poor, they're willing to take more risks with their lives. They're willing to impose greater health costs on themselves in terms of their lifestyle choices. You know, so they will migrate from a village and maybe be willing to live in a slum nearer a place where there is some effluent. So I'm not saying don't impose controls on these, but these are things you have to be kept in mind, that safety standards, maybe they should not be the same across countries. So it's not environmental racism, I mean, it's a more complex issue.
No, I agree, it's a very complex issue, and I think that right now is definitely not the time to debate, but that is an issue that needs to be debated. I disagree with you, but I think that there is no forum to disagree. And so now there's a forum, I think these are matters that need to be discussed. Should same standards apply to all human beings, or should it be different depending on what circumstances? And would we, suppose we say India, would we subject ourselves, or we sit there and ask what the worker should be subjected to? In this whole setting a standard for the worker is not asked. The worker is definitely making a choice for poisons over poverty, but that is not a good choice to give in a civilized society. So, what I mean,
when you bring corporations, they are workers who come and are willing to migrate to an area at some risk.
What I was saying is that this migration is seen as if it's natural, and the poverty is seen as if it is
something that
they just happens over there. Impoverishment is an active act of this economy. And you said, I don't understand how the economy works. I actually don't think the economy works. I think the economy is broken. The economy is based on an unsustainable concept called growth. It can only be, the only limits that are placed are by nature. Natural limits are almost, I don't know how many of you believe that climate change is real. Because if you believe that climate change is real, we cannot be doing this saying, okay, fine, we will change all nuclear to wind power and solar, and then we will have green energy, we will have a green capitalism, we will have a green economy, and we'll have little green people running around buying green things. That is not going to happen. Because you'll be limited by the availability of water. Kodaikanal is a boom town, does not have water, cannot boom. You want to build, you know, highways and expressways across, cutting across the country, saying you're going to increase the GDP. You might increase the GDP while you're putting concrete on the ground. But when the water goes, what happens to you? The water will go, because you can't tell water, don't go because I'm developing, wait for another 20 years. Not going to happen. So I'm saying the fundamentals, how many of you have learned the limits of natural resources? How many of you have learned about the Stockholm syndrome? How many of you have learned about planetary boundaries? If these things don't inform your economy is doomed to destruct.
I have very eclectic views, and in a sense, I don't think many people on this planet today know anything about the monetary history of the 1920s. I mean, the gold standard was revived. But the gold standard was a natural sort of barrier to unbridled growth. And that unbridled growth came from left-wing Keynesian economists. So under what Milton Friedman would call an honest-to-God gold standard, there would be periods of growth followed by long periods of inactivity. So this endless quest for growth has not come. So see, there are very complex issues that you yourself may not be aware of. I'm not
this
thing. But I mean, so you got to separate, you say, take a concrete agenda, you know.
I agree with that.
Let us get Hindustan Lever to this. But I'm saying the broader thing of, now it's both sustainable, in a sense, the Western economies are broken, and that's why interest rates are zero. The sign of a broken economy is zero interest rate. they're just coming up now. India and so on are still coming from a level of poverty where some growth is possible and so on. And it's what people want. It's pulling millions of people out of poverty. I mean, the average person now, you see if you are better, you see if you take liberalization as a whole, I mean, a lot of people are better off. They're not hungry, they're not suffering. I mean, the poor are more concerned about sending their kids to school, whereas 25 years ago, we had a spread meal. So the simple-minded sort of opposition to free market, and I won't want to free, I'll just say market, is to me, one is it's not a realistic understanding of how things are. And also, in a sense, a corporation as a villain of the piece, a corporation is an intermediary between a buyer and a seller. Okay. It's a specific form of intermediary. And in fact, true free market economists say corporations should exist. They operate by custom, command, and convention. I mean, the whole theory is to why corporations develop. But if you look at why the tobacco companies compare tobacco with union leaders, okay, the tobacco companies initially, when there were protests against this, they did the same stalling and this and that and so on. But they didn't succeed. They're completely decimated because the customers themselves
50 realized years. 50
that
years.
Smoking kills.
50 years later.
Because, yeah, no.
Without a rap song.
Still,
without a rap song.
For pregnant women to smoke,
yeah.
After funding thousands of studies in universities to promote
yeah.
tobacco, only then.
No, but I'm saying that you're right in saying that actionable things have to be very small,
yeah,
very targeted and limited. I totally agree with you. On the other point, I think that what we should look at is, yes, there are different points of view. I mean, it's not as if the whole world is made by people who think capitalism is a great thing. There are freaks like me who do not subscribe to that. And there is a place for that point of view. And so I'm saying we'll find out ways by which we can engage with that point of view as well. And definitely, I don't understand monetary theory as you do. And
if people realize this unsustainable growth, which I think is unsustainable, did not come out of the 19th century laissez-faire economy. It came out of the abandoning of the gold standard by the interest rate cut in 1927.
Right. So there might be other ways of fixing it. That's a great idea.
And then you got the depression and all that. So these are much more complex issues and so on. In fact, I think generally people need a lot of open education, discussion, debate on many matters. Which
yeah. No, I agree. I think that definitely there needs to be cross-education. I'm willing to be to learn more about this because it definitely finance. I have no idea how the stock market reacts so happily when something is very sad for me happens. So these are things that one can understand and it will help in trying to have the debate move forward. Yeah.
It's more of a dilemma that after, I didn't know much about this before, now I'm probably more well informed. And my question is that what do we as individuals do once we walk out of this room after this? In the capacity as heads of institutions, an esteemed institution of national importance, as heads of department, researchers, artists, students, what stand do we take once we walk out of this room? Because it's very easy to deliberate or talk about or give suggestions based on our own learnings are our own, specializations, whatever people have probably done their PhDs in or whatever. Someone will take a very economic standpoint of, an economic stand, or someone will take an environmental stand. But as an individual, or let's say especially as a student, what am I supposed to do? Because I don't know how many of who are here are professors and. Because I don't see many students here which are probably the next generation who should be taking these courses ahead, who should be involved in the policy making and these discourses. How as individuals are we going to involve with this? I mean, this is one such matter which has come to light, but once you walk out of the room, what are we going to do?
So, I mean, that's not a question that, I think that's a question that you can ask yourselves, but the fact that you want to do something is very good. The second thing that I would say, which would apply across the board, is question, which means that don't take what I said at face value. This is a point of view. I'm saying it based on facts. It's an interpretation of facts. It's my own point of view. But take these things, definitely have open debates with your faculty, with your students on this, and see what you can do that makes sense to you. That's all I will say, because I'm saying I've not come here to ask you to boycott Unilever. I've come here to say that you've only been told one side of the story. And that side of the story has been told with a lot of money. And so that side of the story, I think, is absolutely, there is no thing for which there's only one story. Even my story is just one story. There's several more stories that need to be told. What do the workers feel about it? Who actually signed the deal, took the money, but could not fight for their town? They've been asked not to fight for the town. What goes on in their mind? So there are many, many, many more stories about this. For the timing, I would say that definitely sign I'm interested, I will question sheet. And the I'm interested, I will question sheet. Don't do it only for Unilever or for anything else. I think there are many, many issues. Unilever is one small little thing in this. But there are many issues that are coming up. How do you find out what the other side of the story is? The other side of the story is a story that you will not be able to hear from privileged spaces because it is not told in those spaces. Even now, we need an English-speaking person from Madras to come. I don't think people would naturally invite a worker or a fisherman or somebody else from the Thoothukudi village to come and talk about their story. That could be changed. Who do you call experts? That could be changed. You could bring in different people. For the time being, for Kodaikanal, what I would suggest is people who have questions about it, people who have already thought that there might be something that they kind of agree with it, disagree with it, I think get in touch with Deepak, who invited us for this meeting, and see what can be done. Whatever needs to be done over here will fit within the culture of your institute and how people think. But the most important thing, I think, is that in Anna University, we had this experience. In Anna University, when we went there, the vice chancellor called us, Dow was recruiting in Anna University, and Dow was giving money to a cultural festival called Kurukshetra. And so we went there, tried to talk to students. We were not allowed. We had to do guerrilla pamphleteering, which means we had to distribute pamphlets as if we are distributing some drugs to our students. And the pamphlets essentially said what Dow is all about. The other side of the story. Not Dow as a 11 lakhs employer, but Dow as a poisoner in Vietnam.
Napalm maker.
All these things we wanted to say. Vice Chancellor said, we will drop the sponsor. Don't have a discussion about this. And we said, don't drop the sponsor. We want to have a discussion because what is needed is not the boycott of Unilever. What is needed is people knowing what the other side of the story is. If you can get the other side of the story out, fantastic. Or other sides of the story out. Get Unilever to come and talk to you as well.
I'm just going
to
add something.
There's nothing wrong with asking for a boycott of Unilever campus.
That is for you to decide.
I think this is a fabulous discussion first. And the questions have been fantastic for everybody. I think even for us, for answering the question, it's been important. I think what you should do is ask similar questions of Unilever. If you're asking actionable things, whether saying boycott or whatever, that is, of course, a different thing. But I think it's fair to say that Unilever needs to be asked difficult questions. And I think it's fair to say that we can all ask them difficult questions, and let's see what happens. Let's see how they respond to the difficult questions. I think that's a fair game if you're having a discussion.
And
what it means to ask difficult questions, only you can design. Whether it means difficult question is a boycott, whether it means refusing something, is only you can decide that.
But if it comes after a long discussion, then I think it makes more sense rather than
I think we might need, for me to say sign that, I may want to see more facts about how much of mercury, because they may come up with different numbers. I think you put 11,600 tons or something. At one point there's some big number there.
1,300 kilograms.
But even, 1,300, how much mercury goes into thermometer? I'm just curious.
These figures, as I said, we don't have the money to do independent verification.
1,300 mercury is just, if it's only thermometers, 1,300, can you think how many thermometers must have been made
in
1,300 tons? Let's start doing the arithmetic.
Yeah, so I'm saying that these numbers are from, so we don't have anything, okay? So whatever numbers and whatever facts we have said is from the either Tamil Nadu Pollution Control Board, which is really crappy data, or from Unilever, which is crappy data. This is all the data that we have. And all this information,
this is the best case scenario. Unilever is saying
Yeah.
that this is what happened. It can only be.
It cannot, as I said, the mass balance.
The data that you saw was all from Unilever or from Pollution Control Board.
Yeah.
all the data you saw was from there.
I mean just think
just
about
so
what I would suggest is
put it in perspective. Yeah.
Yeah. If there's a then
I mean this is the first question I had when I saw your presentation. How much of
yes sir.
Yeah, okay, no, sir. Vivek. I don't teach you.
Sorry.
What is the cost estimate?
I just pulled that number out of the hat. Nobody knows. I said $5 million for the cleanup. Because one of the figures that we saw was $4 million. We increased it by one that it can match Paul Polman's salary. Yeah, I mean, I think that expertise is the, see, basically what, it is not expertise that is required. It is backbone. It's, because in science, what is required most is integrity. If you have integrity, then the trial remediation was a total failure. And who said it was a failure? Unilever said it was a failure. On the basis of that failure, upscaling has been, because they've said 9 out of 10 retort trials failed. So there's no room for interpretation. The guy says that we failed. On the basis of this, saying now that small retort which failed 9 out of 10 times has to be upscaled and made into a big retort so we can have a bigger failure. But this permission has been given. And a scientific experts committee with 5 people including CLRI dudes have approved this.
Because tomorrow they can say, look, I did something.
Yeah, no, that's possible. But yes, the expertise for this can definitely be got. And we can always also outsource or bring in expertise from other places.
We have a 7 p.m. hard stop, unfortunately. The classroom has to be locked at 7 p.m. But I'm sure Nithi and Krishna are around for a little bit, so we can continue having the discussion, but that has to happen outside. We will have to move out because the classroom has to be
So people have not, sorry, the sign-up sheet. Is
yes, the sign-up sheet that is going around.
Which will be given to Deepak.
On behalf of all of you, thank you very much. Very grateful to both of you. I don't think we had, I think I did a quick count, about 12% of IIMB's faculty was in attendance. And I don't think we've had this at other events. So obviously you picked up magic. Thank you.
What did you mean?